Hey, out there in YouTube land, it's John Feld, back with another video, and I shall be discussing Swedish designer Marik and the three films she designed for Ingmar Bergman. Born on June 3rd, 1923 in Leningrad, now St. Petersburg, Russia, she knew at 12 years old she wanted to be a theatrical designer. She attended the University College of Arts, Crafts, and Design in Stockholm, where she studied decorative painting, perspective theory, and watercolor. She joined the Royal Dramatic Theater in Stockholm, and from 1948 until her retirement in 1985, she worked on 120 productions as costume and scenic designer, working with all the masters of Swedish theater. Voss crossed paths with filmmaker Ingmar Bergman, and he offered her the job of costume designer on his film The Virgin Spring. Other than a television production of Eugene O'Neill's Huey in 1958, this was Voss's first major film. Set in medieval Sweden and inspired by the 13th century ballad, Per Tyerson's Daughters of Vanya. When Voss came up with the designs of The Virgin Spring, she avoided how medieval films were designed at that time, which were opulent but historically inaccurate. She used woolens, linens, cottons, silks, and leather. At the time the film was shot in 1959, the costumes were quite impressive and realistic looking with a little dirt on them. In the opening scene, we meet the servant girl, Ingeri, and she wears a wool shift with a small leather belt tied above her pregnant belly. Maretta, wife of Tore, wears a wimple and a long shift dress and studded leather belt, and her cook Frida wears a biggin, pinafore, shift dress, and I really like the hemming on both garments. Here is Tore in a biggin, long leather coat, trimmed with fur over a wool tunic and belt, wool pants and leather shoes tied around his ankles. Karin, the daughter, insists on wearing her finest clothes when she goes on her journey, which consists of a yellow shift embroidered with Scandinavian motifs, a wool bodice, a long skirt embroidered with gold thread, and a leather belt to make the skirt poof out, completed with a long fur-trimmed blue cape. Here is a color photo of the costume at a Bergman display, and the only items missing are the bodice and the belt. Tore bids Karin goodbye, not knowing this will be the last time he will see her alive, and Ingeri then accompanies Karin on the way to church, but stops midway when she becomes scared of going into the woods. This is the one-eyed bridge keeper that Ingeri briefly stays with until he makes advances and she runs away. His clothes are grungy and worn out. They consist of a matted fur biggin and a patched-together fur cloak over a ratted tunic held in place with pin and chain. Here are the herdsmen, appropriately adorned in raggedy clothes with holes and frayed edges made from wool. The mute herdsman wears an aged leather doublet, and the little brother wears what I can only assume is a hand-me-down ensemble that was altered to fit him by his mother. Now, I can only assume these characters, these are their only clothes because they're all worn and threadbare. Karin shares her lunch with these three individuals, and in turn, the two older brothers rape and murder her. They steal her clothes and leave her in the middle of the woods while Ingeri watches in absolute horror. The herdsmen make their way to the farmhouse, not knowing it's Karin's home, and ask for shelter that night. The thin herdsman offers Karin's clothes to sell, claiming to be his sister's clothes. Tore and Marita recognize the items. Ingeri returns and, out of guilt, says those are the men who raped and murdered Karin. Tore wears a leather smock as he plots his revenge where he kills all three herdsmen. Ingeri then brings Tore and Marita where Karin's body lays, and they lift her from the ground, and a spring forms from where her head rested. The Virgin Spring was released in the United States on November 14, 1960, and was a hit with critics, but generated controversy with the rape scene causing several walkouts. Though not explicit compared to today's films, The scene is still shocking, and the film had some shots removed and was banned in Fort Worth, Texas on the grounds of obscenity. Come Oscar time, The Virgin Spring received 2 Oscar nominations, 1 for Best Foreign Film and 1 for Best Costume Design for Marik Voss. It took home Best Foreign Film, but unfortunately Voss lost to Edith Head and Edward Stevenson's designs for The Facts of Life. Bergman and Voss worked together again in 1963 on The Silence, where Voss designed costumes for Gunnel Lindholm and Ingrid Thulin. Then, in 1968, Voss was the production designer on Bergman's horror film Hour of the Wolf, creating a set of bleak isolation. They collaborated 6 more productions at the Royal Dramatic Theater: The Seagull in 1961, Wojciech in 1972, The Wild Duck in 1972, Ghost Sonata in 1973, To Damascus in 1974, and concluding with a dream play in 1985. In September 1971, Bergman began production on Cries and Whispers at Tahinje Gnadsby Castle in Marie Fred Södermanlands Ian, Sweden, and Voss was assigned double duty as costume and production designer. The interior of the estate was dilapidated, and Voss and her crew had free rein to fix it up, repaint it, recarpet it in all the rooms that were to be filmed in. The color scheme was a variety of reds, white, brown, gold, beige, gray, and black. Red is the dominant color throughout the film, and instead of fade to black, there is fade to red. The story is set in turn of the century, and Agnes, played by Harriet Anderson, is dying of uterine cancer and being looked after by her sister Maria and Karin, played respectively by Liv Ullmann and Ingrid Thulin, and housekeeper Anna, portrayed by Kari Silwan. Bergman envisioned 4 women in a red room, and Voss delivered his vision. Though set in turn of the century, Voss did not design the dresses to look historically accurate. They have the shape of that era, but gone were all the intricate period details. When we first see the women, they are wearing white robes and nightgowns. Here is Ullmann with Bergman in between takes wearing the white robe with lace sleeves and closed with a hook and eye. Here is Anna praying to God, thanking him and asking him to care for her deceased daughter. She is wearing a tan and beige plaid maid's uniform with collar and cuffs and apron. And I want to acknowledge how beautifully lit and composed this image is by cinematographer Sven Nyquist. And here is another image I love, where Karin is sitting at her desk dressed in gray, dark gray turquoise ensemble with frilled cuffs and a small leg of button sleeves, emotionally exhausted by Agnes's inevitable death. Here is a publicity still of all 4 characters, and Agnes is in a high-collared blue and white striped dress instead of the nightgown she wears throughout the film. This is a deleted scene from the film where it shows Agnes in the blue and white dress and a painter's smock working on a picture, and it is mentioned that Agnes paints in the film. I wish this scene had stayed in the film and we could learn more about Agnes's character. I want to go back to this publicity photo and point out Maria's red lace dress. This dress says it all about Maria's character. Maria is a charming and flirtatious lady, and openly emotional and affectionate, but deep down she is shallow and false. When Agnes reminisces about her mother, she is also played by Liv Ullmann in a dual role, and mother is dressed in a gathered silk chiffon dress that is vaguely 1860s. The sleeves are full below the elbow, similar to the styles of that period. Here is another photo where you can see more of the dress, and she is surrounded by Voss's exquisite set decorations. Back to the film's present setting, Maria wears a lavender dress with a lace-trimmed neckline and a pearl necklace as she calls to David, the doctor played by Bergman regular Erlend Josephson, who has just seen Agnes. In another flashback, David visits the manor to attend to Anna's sick daughter. Maria insists he stay the night where she serves him dinner and then seduces him that very evening wearing the red lace dress. Later, Maria wears this peach collar and rose-colored lounging dress with a high collar and cameo brooch. In Agnes's final hours, Karin and Maria are in Agnes's bedroom watching her die a slow, painful death, with only Anna holding her, doing her best to comfort her. This scene is similar to the Edvard Munch painting, Death in the Sick Room, painted in 1895. In the most famous scene in the whole film, Anna holds the now-dead Agnes, and it resembles Michelangelo's Pietà, a sculpture of the Virgin Mary holding the dead body of Christ. Now we come to the elder sister, Karin. Karin is a character cold and unfeeling, not only to herself, but others. As well, I doubt this woman has ever had a happy day in her life. Because of this cold personality, she is often seen in dark colors and black most of the time. Here is Anna in her formal maid's uniform, attending to the dinner of Karin, dressed all in black with pearls, and her husband Frederick, played by Georg Arlin, dressed in a traditional tuxedo. After dinner, Anna is undressing Karin and getting her ready for bed. This is a lengthy yet interesting scene where we see all the layers of clothes that goes into dressing a lady of that era. Removing of the jewelry, the dress, the petticoats, the corset, the chemise, the stockings, and then putting on the nightgown and robe. Anna then gathers up all the items and leaves the room. Karin then does something very, very shocking, which I am not going to reveal here. You will have to see the movie if you want to know. Here is the reason for her shocking act. Her husband, Frederick, you can tell just by looking at him, he is the personification of the cold-blooded bastard. The actor who played Frederick, Georg Arlin, must have had a long career playing villains. Here is the happy family gathered together after the funeral, and they are all dressed in traditional black, the respective husbands in black suits and the dark overcoats, and the ladies all in their mourning attire, trimmed with dark gray fur, hats, and veils. Anna is allowed to stay at the manor for a month, and she is given Agnes's diary, from which she reads about a mild fall afternoon where the three sisters were going for a walk on the grounds in their finest white dresses. It is here we see more period details in the clothes and hats. The scene shows all three sisters on a swing and Anna pushing it. It's at that moment Agnes experiences perfection. Released December 21st, 1972 in New York City, Cries and Whispers was an immediate critical and surprisingly commercial hit, made on a $450,000 budget, it wound up grossing $1 million at the box office. Here are Bergman, Voss, Nyquist, and the rest of the cast at a press conference promoting the film, and on the wall you can see Voss's costume sketches on full display. On a technicality, Cries and Whispers was eligible for Oscar consideration in 1973, and it wound up getting nominated for Best Picture, a rarity for a foreign film, Best Director, Best Original Screenplay, Best Cinematography, and Best Costume Design for Our Lady Marik Voss. Sven Nyquist wound up winning a very deserved Oscar for his use of natural light, and here he is with Cicely Tyson, who presented him the award. Voss, however, was not so fortunate, and she wound up losing to Edith Head again for The Sting. In 2009, theater director Ivo van Hove adapted Bergman's film to the stage and set it in the present. Agnes is now a multimedia artist and videotapes her death. During the 70s, Voss continued to work in the theater, and in 1978, she was production designer on the film In Och In, an Ingmar Bergman-type film, minus Bergman. Her next film turned out to be her greatest artistic triumph, Fanny and Alexander. Voss and Bergman teamed up again, and Fanny and Alexander was the biggest production either of them ever worked on. $6 million was the film's budget and the largest for a Swedish film. The story was about the Ekdals, a large and loving family who owned and operated a large theater in 1907, and the events that happened in their lives over the course of 2 years. The film opens on Christmas Eve, and Helena Ekdahl, played by Gunn Wahlgren, wears this beautiful Christmas gown of red and velvet brocade. This is my second favorite costume of all time. I first saw Fanny and Alexander back in 1992 when I rented it from a small video store in Arlington, Texas, and unfortunately it was the dubbed version. When Helena made her entrance in this gown, my jaw dropped and I couldn't get over how stunning it was. Here is a sketch again, along with the sketch of Isaac's costume. They are on and off again lovers in the film, and here is a picture of Helena stealing a kiss from Isaac after he gives her a brooch as a Christmas present. It is refreshing to see people of a certain age having a passionate affair. The Ekdahl family performs the nativity play, and here is Voss's two sketches, and after the show, everyone arrives all dressed in their Christmas finery, the ladies in their most colorful gowns and the men in their best suits. They all sit down to a lavish spread for an elaborate Scandinavian feast. Looking at this scene in the film, the image reminds me of the paintings of Carl Larsson, and I have a feeling that production designer Anna Asp used a lot of his work as a reference. Here, in one of the most joyful scenes in the film, is when the whole family joins hands and sings Nu är det jul igen throughout the house, dancing around. This is an old Scandinavian Christmas song that translates to Now it is Christmas again. The family gathers around Oscar Ekdahl, played by Alan Edwall, father of Fanny and Alexander, and husband to Emily, played by Eva Froling, to hear him read the Christmas story. Here is Emily and Alma, played by Mona Malm, after all the festivities, having a laugh while the children play with their new toys. Here's a sketch of Emily's Christmas dress, and I also wanted to include the other costume not seen in the theatrical version. This costume was seen in the miniseries version that aired on Swedish television in 1984, and it is a beautiful work of art that cannot be overlooked. After all the Christmas festivities have come to an end, the Ekdahl family begins their next production of Hamlet, where Oscar plays the Ghost King and then winds up having a stroke that kills him. Oscar becomes a ghost, unwilling to go to heaven because he wants to remain with his family. Here he wears a white suit, traditional clothes of the afterlife, and here's Voss's sketch of all the mourning attire worn by the ladies of the film, and the executed designs at the funeral scene where we meet Bishop Edvard Vigeros, played by Jan Malmsjö. During the course of the movie, Emily wears a necklace that I have always found fascinating, and my interpretation is this was a gift from Oscar, and it means the world to her, and she never takes it off. Here is Voss's sketch of the mint green suit Emily wears to visit Vigerus's home. She has accepted his marriage proposal, and he makes one insane request from her. He requests that she leave everything behind, only bringing herself and her children into the marriage, and against her better judgment, Emily agrees. The wedding of Emily and Bishop Edvard Vigerus looks more like a funeral than a wedding. Everyone is dressed in very dark colors. Vigerus is in uniform. Emily's wedding dress is black and gray, trimmed with light gray lace. Looking at the rest of the family, it is clearly not a joyous occasion. Everyone looks like they would rather be somewhere else, as the color reflects everyone's mood. Vigerus and his new family then head home after the wedding, and they have no idea of the hell that awaits them. The Vigerus homestead looks like more like a prison than a home, with all of its drab and gloomy interiors. The family and staff wear clothes that look like prison laundry in gray, navy, and black. Here is Harriet Anderson playing Justina, one of the maids, quite a contrast from playing Agnes in Cries and Whispers. The children's room looks more like a jail cell, with bars on the windows and the doors being locked every evening. The children wear night clothes that look like prison uniforms minus stripes. Alexander makes up a story how the two bishops' daughter dies and Justina rats him out to Vigerus. It is then Alexander learns how controlling and abusive his stepfather is. Helena, now in her summer home, dressed in a cool white dress, Marik Voss and Anna Asp's designs blend together seamlessly, and it's amazing when a set and costume designer work together in sync. The scene reminds me of a painting by Carl Larsson with the large window and all the light illuminating the room. Emily comes to visit Helena, telling her how life with Vigerus is a living hell, and notice the contrast to both ladies' clothes. Helena in soft white and Emily in stark black and gray. Isaac, fortunately, comes to the children's rescue under the guise of buying a trunk from which Vigerus, and he sneaks the children out in. They stay at his antique shop until they are returned to the Ekdal home. Emily, now pregnant, plots her own escape as Vigerus becomes sleepy after drinking hot broth laced with sleeping pills, meant for Emily. Emily is reunited with the Ekdals in time to celebrate the christening of her newborn daughter, and being reunited with her children. Here is a sketch of Gustav Soot, and he was played by Jarl Kurl, and his suit reflects the joyous occasion, and he delivers a wonderful monologue about the importance of love, joy, life, and most of all, family. Fanny and Alexander was released June 17, 1983 in the United States and was immediately praised by critics as Bergman's best work. And it was then Bergman announced this would be his last film. Come award season, Fanny and Alexander wound up being nominated for 6 Academy Awards, Bergman for Best Director in Original Screenplay, and winning Best Cinematography for Sven Nykvist, his second, Best Production Design for Anna Asp, and then Best Foreign Film, accepted by the film's producer, Jorn Donner, and Bergman's wife, Ingrid von Rosen, and last and certainly not least, our dear lady Marik Voss finally won her Oscar for Best Costume Design. She couldn't be at the ceremony for she was working in Munich on a dream play with Bergman. It is said Marik made a wool jumper and cap for her Oscar, and it sat on a shelf next to her stove. I wish there was a photo of this, but I guess one can't have everything. She also wrote and published a book about her work on Fanny and Alexander, but it is only available in Swedish and copies are rare. After working on the production of a dream play at the Royal Dramatic Theater with Bergman, she decided to retire from show business and move to the island of Gotland and lived in the town of Wallingbo, and it was there she spent her days designing sweaters for a local wool company. She passed away on July 13, 1994, and for me, she truly was a Swedish enigma because she never put herself in the spotlight and remained humble throughout her career. I hope you enjoyed this video. Like and subscribe, and that's the way the cow ate the cabbage.